Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
As the Airport Commission meeting for IACO comes to an open, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, this is the April 26th meeting of the 2018 of the Airport Commission. And first thing on the agenda is the consent items.
Roll call.
Roll call is first thing. It's above my there, okay.
Commissioner Sonio?
Here.
Commissioner Fors?
Here.
Commissioner Johnson?
Here.
Commissioner Purvis? Commissioner Shoemaker?
Here.
Commissioner White?
Here.
Chairperson McGregor?
Here. Now we can go to the consent agenda. Would any of the commissioners like any item pulled off of the consent agenda? If not, I'll entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda.
So moved.
I'd second it.
It's been moved and seconded. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Sonio?
Approved.
Commissioner Fors?
Approved.
Commissioner Johnson?
Approved.
Commissioner Purvis? Commissioner Shoemaker?
Approved.
Commissioner?
Abstain. I wasn't here.
Commissioner White?
Abstain.
Chairperson McGregor?
Aye. Okay, considerations. The 2017 Airport Layout Plan and Narrative Report for the Salinas Municipal Airport. Mr. Godown.
Good evening, Mr. Chair and members of the Commission. Wanted to bring the Commission up to date and actually move an item to City Council for final approval. Back in 2013, we started the process of updating our airport layout plan and providing an accompanying narrative report. And over the last 2 years or so, we've brought in a couple different reports to the Commission, just providing an update as to where we're at in the process. So tonight, I have Patrick Taylor from Kaufman Associates. They're the firm that actually helped us put together the update and narrative and the narrative report for the ALP. And he's going to provide you a presentation on the final product. So with that, I introduce Mr. Patrick Taylor from Kaufman Associates. You can be right.
Good evening.
Hi.
Good evening.
Oh, this is the answer. Okay, like Brett said, I'm with Kaufman Associates, so we were working as a subconsultant to Kimley Horn, the consulting engineer at the airport. We were asked to update the airport layout plan, and along with that is a narrative report that supports the projects that are identified in the airport layout plan. Just a little background. The FAA requires that the airport have an up-to-date airport layout plan. So the airport layout plan is those technical drawings of the airport that show the current condition and the future condition. You've probably seen those for the airport. And it is when you have an updated airport layout plan, that is what they base their funding on. So any projects, particularly projects related to the air side, so runways and taxiways, has to be depicted on the airport layout plan in order to get AIP funding from the FAA. Now, a narrative report with that is a narrower focus than the master plan. So a master plan is a more comprehensive study. This is a little bit more of a shorter term study. So we were identifying some focus areas to focus on, which we did, and we've provided some solutions on those. So important considerations in the narrative report are forecasts. So aviation demand, as well as facility requirements, what's needed in terms of hangars, ramp area, pavement. Some development alternatives were also considered for the runways, and then there's a recommended plan. So there's going to be several pictures up here that have a lot of detail on them. You're not expected to be able to read those. I'll give you a brief summary here. I understand each of you has also been provided an electronic copy of the report, so it kind of looks like this. In terms of the forecasts, so over the next 20 years, we're forecasting a need for about 83,000 square feet of hangar space. About 35 new planes, about half of those could be larger business jets, and that is a trend in the general aviation industry. We also are looking to meet the design standards, so the last airport layout plan, between the last one and this one,
the FAA published a new airport design manual, and a lot of those standards changed. So we looked at this airfield to apply those new design standards. There's always ongoing maintenance. We'll point out those needs and then various support facilities. So just briefly, this is a depiction of kind of the priority maintenance projects. This was developed by Kim Lee Horn. We've been able to include it in the narrative report because it relates directly to the capital improvement program. So the colored areas, so for example, the first priority is runway 1331 in terms of rehabilitating that, and then runway 826, and then other pavement areas to follow in subsequent years. I know you can't see this one very well, but this is identifying all those areas on the airfield where the design standards changed and that we had, that we looked at in this study. So there's a lot of changes in terms of taxiways, having direct access from ramp areas to runways, for example. So the new design standard is to force pilots to make a turn onto a parallel taxiway before they then make another turn onto a runway. So you've got several places on the airport where pilots could inadvertently enter the active runway system because it's got direct access. So the airport layout plan identifies projects to remedy situations like that. Other focus areas. So one important one that became very important with the FAA is meeting the standard for the runway protection zone. So this is that trapezoidal area you may have seen on some depictions of the airport beyond the runway ends. The standard for that is to be clear of incompatible land uses, and the most prominent incompatible land use within a runway protection zone is homes. So that really stands out for the FAA. At the end of the runway 8 end, there are 4 homes that fall in the runway protection zone right now. So one of the part of the analysis that we did was how can we pull that runway protection zone off those homes and preserve the runway length for 826, the longest runway at the airport. So the solution took quite a long time of talking with the FAA. Their initial position was to potentially shorten the runway, and that wasn't a very good idea because there's a lot of operators out there who indicate that they need the full runway length. In fact, they prefer a longer runway. So we kind of went down that path with the FAA. Brett got some of the operators to write letters in support of maintaining the runway length. So we have a solution there, which is actually to shift about 400 feet of the runway, take it off the 8 end, and put it on the 2-6 end at some point in the future. In the middle there, on the bottom, is the runway safety area for the runway 13 end. That's about a little more than 300 feet long, and it's supposed to be 600 feet long now. So that's the yellow area at the end of the runway 13 end. And then on the 31 end, the runway safety area there beyond the runway end doesn't quite meet grading standards. So essentially, these are things that point to projects sometime in the future to remedy these situations. So this is an overview of the entire airport. There's a lot of detail in here. Essentially, the primary projects are that 826 runway shift project, the runway safety area projects for 1331, all of the regular pavement maintenance projects, as well as some land use designation changes for allowing some non-aviation uses on airport land, which the FAA permits if you have enough land reserved for aviation uses in the future. The program put together is a 20-year capital improvement program. In this exhibit, everything colored in yellow is in the next 5 years. Orange is years 6 through 10. And then green is years 10 through 20. This is the total list of projects that have been identified through the plan. I'm not gonna go through each and every one of them. This list can and will change. Every year, Brett goes to the FAA and talks about what the next 5-year projects are, and they talk about funding. So when funding's not available, projects get moved, and project priority can change. But what we feel confident in is that we've put together a collection of potential projects that Brett can work with the FAA over the next several years to move around in priority and to get funding for. Overall, we identified about $40 million worth of potential projects over the next 20 years for the airport. So in the short term, the high priority items are rehabilitation of both runways and beginning to address the runway safety areas. That's almost $10 million worth of projects. And you all probably know that the funding match for most projects out at the airport is a 90-10 match, so you can always kind of keep that 10% in mind for the local responsibility. And then in the intermediate term, a master plan update. The master plan hasn't been updated, the overall master plan, since 2004. FAA likes to see that updated about every 7 to 10 years. Now, the work that we've done on these past two narrative reports has helped advance that and keep you all current. But there's some other elements within a master plan that could be beneficial. So sometime in the future, you want to be considering that. So just a couple of key takeaways. I don't want to take too much of your time, but there is an ongoing battle to preserve the length of 826 out there. And we had some very in-depth and serious conversations with the FAA, as I mentioned before, where they were wanting justification for the existing length, which we ended up being able to provide and get. But I think that's going to come up again in the future, particularly when there's funding needs. 826 is planned to be shifted about 400 feet, so 400 off of the 8N and added to the 26 end. Some airport land is being identified for non-aviation revenue support purposes, and that's important. You know, one of the grant assurances for the airport is to try and be as self-sustaining as possible. And most general aviation airports that break even or make a profit have a substantial revenue stream from non-aviation sources. So those are land leases, essentially, for non-aviation uses. The moat that's going around the runway 13N, that's planned to be removed at some point as part of the runway safety area issue. Perimeter road and fence around that area is planned to kind of be depressed below the elevation surfaces. So the idea there is to try and preserve the golf course. And that was the method that we arrived at and that the FAA agreed to as well. So I mentioned that technical drawing, the airport layout plan. You can see that there is a lot to it. This is the airport layout plan that has been approved by the FAA. So this is ready to go into action and to serve as your resource for obtaining future grants with the FAA. So if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer.
Questions? Commissioner Shoemaker?
Yeah, I'm curious about the roads. I couldn't figure out what the deal was, because is that runway safety area, or is that the 40-to-1 slope, or what requires them to be depressed? And to follow on that, if you're going to depress the road, at 1-3, but then on 3-1, you have to bring grading up, I assume. That's the other thing I couldn't figure out, is the grading at 3-1 to comply with the grading. I assume that's to fill the areas that are low in the runway safety area. Yep. So, but you're going to, in one area, you're going to lower the road, and another area, you're going to fill. Can you expound on that?
So on the north end, so on the 13 end, the reason for depressing the road is actually to be outside of the object-free area. That is the blue in the middle lower picture. The design standard there is the objects cannot penetrate above the elevation of the runway. So that's the reason for depressing the road, the service road and the perimeter fence. It would actually be under that elevation.
Would that be the top of the vehicle under the elevation, or just the road?
So a vehicle could go through there. It's the permanent structures that are the key. So it's the fence. So the fence
You'd lower the fence.
Yes, but the road has to be lowered as well, even though they're not a permanent structure. So I misspoke there.
So you're going to fill the moat, because the moat is an obstruction.
Well, the moat goes through the runway safety area right now, so that is what it is an obstruction of.
Okay, and the road goes through it, and it's the same elevation as the runway.
Right.
So you're going to lower it?
So the idea is to keep them below that object-free area elevation, both. So cars included, or fuel trucks, or whatever is going to be passing by there, shouldn't be above the elevation of the object-free area. Now, the runway safety area, that inner portion, the yellow, is even more important. It has to be clear of anything. So it can't have the fence in it or the road in it.
Or the moat.
Or the moat.
But the road, you said the vehicle has to be, cannot penetrate the area.
Right.
So the vehicle, you're going to have to lower the road 6 feet?
It would have to be lowered at least 6 feet, yeah.
Is
that the final depth would be determined during engineering, so you probably want to pick, you know, some car that, you know, maybe even the size of a fuel truck, so it could be 8 feet or more.
Yeah, that seems like a lot of change in elevation there, where at the other end of the runway, you got to fill because there is a change in elevation there.
Yeah, that actually is just a grading standard, so the runway safety area cannot exceed more than 5% grade, and in the yellow part, it drops off precipitously.
So your road would drop down 5% grade to the road?
Well, the road down there doesn't go through the safety area.
The road down there being?
On the 31 end?
31, yeah, right.
So, okay. So that road is
okay.
Down the hillside, that's, so it's already
exactly,
below.
That's already down there. You just need to grade that. The road that's at right. The other end, it seems that's going to be, you're going to drop down 5% to 8 feet below and then come back up to the golf course to get the road in there?
So literally your safety area, the runway safety area, could be flat and then cut down to put the service road and the fence in. That's the extreme. You might have a little bit of a slope to it. All that would be determined in an engineering time. The reason for this solution was to preserve the golf course and to preserve it in a way that met FAA standards.
Okay, so you're lowering the road to preserve the golf course, which is income, which is
important income.
Yeah.
The alternative, I mean, we looked at a number of different alternatives. That's the one we arrived at that met both of those goals. The others would have taken out about 4 holes on the golf course, and that didn't seem like the right thing to do with the revenue that the airport gets off that, which is critical.
Yeah, okay. Okay, I'm that's enough. I'm good. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Commissioner Sonio?
So by lowering this fence, I mean, what would be the height of the fence? I mean, right now, the way you're describing it, I picture it, you know, we just walk along, step over it, and enter airport, you know, property, or somebody with ill right. will could.
So I think it's like a 3-foot fence right now, except right at the end of the runway is the wood fence. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of a bit of a hodgepodge of fencing. I mean, standard perimeter fencing for an airport is 6 or 8 feet.
Right.
So if you were going to invest in a project to do something like this, I would think that you would put in standard perimeter fencing.
But then that would be higher than the end of the runway?
That'll be down.
Right, so that's where that would be a determining factor on how much the road is depressed. So remember, the road is just a perimeter service road.
Right.
So it's not a public road. Okay. So there's not a lot of traffic.
Okay. We'll take a crack at it real quick.
Okay, so within the safety area and outside of the safety area, as he was mentioning, there's a certain tolerance where we can have a gradient dropping down from the edge of the runway. And so the idea is to drop off at a gradual gradient, something that doesn't exceed the 5%. And our initial calculations have shown that if we drop off at below an initial 5%, then after we get out of the safety area, we can drop off a little bit more and create a swale. And so the fence and the road will sit down at the bottom of the swale while we preserve the safety area and we preserve the golf course. So it's kind of like this U-shaped dip that allows for a road and a fence line to sit in there. And you still wouldn't be able to drop over it. It would be a 6-foot elevation by the time you got to the edge of it. So that was the idea behind preserving the golf course, preserving the airport, and meeting the FAA standards. Does that make a little bit more sense with meeting the gradients that come off the edge of the runway? Below 5%.
Commissioner Forrest? I'd just like to make a comment that 6 to 8 feet off the runway seems a big issue for safety. You have a plane like in the wintertime and then the wind's blowing really good and you're trying to get that plane to come in there on that runway. Right over here is 6 to 8 feet drop off the runway. That seems to me like a safety issue.
No, it won't be right off the edge of the runway. It'll be more, the 8 feet drop will be more 200 feet, 250 feet off the edge of the runway. Around where you see the sand traps in the picture here. It's quite a ways off.
Oh, okay.
Off the edge of the runway. It's not right near the edge. It's,
yeah, okay.
We're doing a real gradual, we're cutting off the top to start dropping it down in the safety area, but meet FAA tolerances. And as soon as you get out of the FAA, the runway safety area, is it 7%? I think.
For the OFA?
Yeah.
That sounds right.
I think it's about 7%. So our grades can start real gradual, and as you get further away from the runway, the grades can get steeper and steeper, and still be within the design standards for the FAA. So,
thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Johnson?
So we're not talking about changing the length of 1331. We're...
No. No,
okay.
We're preserving lengths at all possible. So in this go-around with our update to the airport layout plan, all runway lengths were preserved.
Great.
Any other questions from the commission? Questions from the public? Not. Is there anything else on the report part of it, Brett?
No, just to kind of just summarize, this is a necessity. We have to update the ALP and have a current ALP in order to get grant funding from the FAA. And in the scheme of things, although we've planned out 20 years, really the focus is the next 5 years. And by the time we finish the next 5 years, it's about time for us to go back to the table again and reevaluate what our priorities are. And we're really getting to that tipping point where we need to start considering doing a full-on airport master plan update versus doing these smaller plans. So when we get to the airport master plan, it's much more of a public process where we have public committees, planning action committees that you participate on, and we invite the community to come in and hear about what we plan on doing at the airport. So this is really just it's a bridging document to keep us in compliance with the FAA and get us out for about 5 years. So the item that's in front of you is to advance this to City Council for final approval. And then this document will be the document for at least the next 5 years that we refer to as it on the 2017 airport layout plan. So that's really what we're going with. So.
Okay, so the next item on that is the resolution, to approve the resolution.
Yes.
And has everybody seen the resolution? Is there a slide of that to stick up there or not?
There is not.
Not,
but
okay.
That's not a bad idea to do in the future.
Is the resolution, is for City Council, is it not? And what we need is a motion to move this to City Council?
We need a motion to send the resolution to the City Council, approve the
resolution,
and send it to City Council.
I'd like to make a motion to move this to the City Council, as presented by Kinley Horn. It's
been moved. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Been moved and seconded to advance the resolution to the City Council for their approval. Any discussion? Now, could we have the roll call, please?
Commissioner Sonio?
Approved.
Commissioner Fors?
Approved.
Commissioner Johnson?
Approved.
Commissioner Purvis? Commissioner Shoemaker?
Approved.
Commissioner White?
Approved.
Chairperson McGregor?
Aye.
Okay, next on the agenda is a request for qualifications, architectural engineering, and construction management services for the Salinas Municipal Airport.
All right. So let me get this. Where are we at? So I'm gonna hop forward real quick to the end of this, just so we can see what it is that the end result is. So we're asking you to recommend us publishing this RFQ for advertisement, and then if the commission so desires, set aside 1 to 2 members to participate on the panel to review the solicitations that come in from the city. So those are the two items that we're looking at. So many of you have heard of Kimley Horn and Associates, and you see Bob sitting here with us often, every meeting. And Bob is actively engaged. He's just not a member of the community that shows up and watches our meetings. He's actually the consultant that's on retainer for the airport to advance items to the FAA so we can get grant funding. So they do engineering services, and they do construction management services. And as part of that, we had Patrick Kaufman Associates, they were the planning firm. So we are covering all of our bases with the FAA. Planning, engineering, and construction management are the items that we have to solicit with the FAA to have a consultant on board to advance items forward. So every 5 years, the FAA requires us to go back to the drawing board and put a solicitation out to secure a consultant for these services. And so we finished up our 5 years with Kimley Horn and Kaufman Associates, so it's time for us to go back out and advertise for their services. The important part of this whole process is that when we do a solicitation, we're not doing it based on a price or anything like that. It's based off of qualifications. So the FAA, through this process, does not care about price. They want us to find the most qualified consultant based off of their qualifications to provide services to the city. So some of the things, as I mentioned before, is, and it's broken down, and this is more FAA lingo, preliminary phase, design phase, and construction phase. The one thing that's different from this solicitation than we did last time, and we did this 5 years ago, and I can't remember, Commissioner Shoemaker, were you on the panel? And then Commissioner McGregor, I think you were on the panel also. At that last solicitation, we were provided the opportunity because of FAA policy to combine all of those types of works, the planning, design, and construction administration and management, all into one contract and select a firm that could provide all those services. The one thing that we did different was is we broke out planning and said that you guys, whoever provides a proposal must come in as a team. We do not want the same consultant doing planning work that is doing the designing and engineering. We separated out those services, and so that's how we wound up with Kaufman Associates and Kimley Horn Associates. They came together as a team. The FAA has since revised what's called the advisory circular, where we get the information to, it's the compliance mechanism that we work through the FAA. The advisory circular is a document that says, if you're gonna do business with the FAA, these are the things that you have to comply with. And in the last go around, when the FAA updated their advisory circular, they took out the planning services and said, no longer can you, under one contract, have planning and engineering together. So in the next few months, we're gonna come back to the commission and put out another RFQ only for planning services. So on this one is engineering and construction management services. That's what this solicitation is for. So some of the work that's done during the preliminary phase is defining scope, survey, and geotechnical investigations. During the design phase, they're doing more environmental work. So you've heard us talk about categorical exclusions, CADEXs, for some of the environmental work that's done for the work that we do here. Plans and specifications and estimates, which you guys saw about 2 months ago, I think, that we brought to you to recommend City Council approve the plan specifications and estimate for runway 1331 and 826. And then now we're gonna be moving on to the construction phase. Bids were due on Tuesday for runway 1331. And so now Kimley Horn is in the process of advertising the bids that came in, and then they'll move on into construction management work for us. This is the timeline that we're looking at. We're gonna publish the RFQ right around May 22nd. Advertise it for 30 days. We'll have a pre-submittal meeting on June 7th. We'll close out the submittal period on June 27th. And then at that point, the panel will convene, and then we will review the proposals. And if it's determined necessary, we can do interviews with the consultants that submitted proposals. And then our hopes is to have this back in front of the commission on July 26 to recommend City Council approve the consultant that we selected for a 5-year retaining agreement. And so with that, we're back to what the recommendation is. So if there's any questions, I'd be more than willing to ask.
Any questions for Commissioner Sonio?
So will the part of the response to the RFQ be on those projects listed for the 5 years, or just more general?
So it's It's both is my answer. So we have general services that we listed off in the RFQ. For example, general services is the consultants helps us put together our capital improvement project submittal that we do to the FAA. Mm-hmm. And part of the preliminary work is grant submittal. And then they help us do some other small items as part of this. But we're required to put in our capital improvement project. So they are submitting, the consultants that do submit are anticipating that we're going to move forward with those projects in our capital improvement program. So it's both.
So they need to be qualified to at least do those five-year projects in that first 5 years?
Yes, okay. Correct. And so the RFQ has several sections in it. One of them is the qualification section. So I think it's 10 years of experience, and within the last 5 years, you've had to done three different projects, and we kind of broke it down that way. So they should, the consultants should be submitting no more than 30 pages of an RFQ for us to review, and that's single-sided. So whoever, if any one of the commissioners decide that they would like to participate on the panel, you have to understand that we can get anywhere from 1 to 10 proposals coming in, and we need to review it and then rank them based off of the criteria that's listed in the RFQ.
Any other questions? Commissioner Johnson?
This is kind of weird. So we pay the consultants to get the grants from the FAA, correct?
No. We pay the consultants to do the preliminary phase, design phase, and construction phase. The consultants just provide those services, and they do build that into their prices for the projects, but no, we don't have individual bills for them doing that type of work. Does that make sense?
Okay.
I guess I could say yes.
I'm a little confused because I thought the FAA demanded us, in order for us to get the grants, to have these consultants. Was that not correct?
So, if we solicit a consultant, which we don't have any staff, any city staff on hand that can do this work. So if we solicit a consultant, we're required to go through this process of selecting consultants based off of qualifications. So you have two options. You can do the work all in-house and do all your grant preparation, the preliminary work, the design work. And so we'd have to hire a city staff member that specializes in doing FAA-type construction work, where they're familiar with all these phases of work, or you can hire out a consultant to do the work. If you hire out a consultant to do the work, you have to go through the RFQ process to select them.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
Any other questions?
A much shorter answer for what I answered earlier is yes, we do pay the consultants to help us do the the grants, but it.
About how much do we pay them?
So consultants, there's a maximum of 20% of the actual project costs that can be allotted for the construction management and engineering and design services. So if it's $1 million project, the max that the FAA would allow them to be paid is $200,000.
Okay.
Commissioner Forrest?
On the volunteer side that you're looking for a couple of people, I have a couple of questions. How much time is involved in that, and how many meetings between now and July would require a volunteer?
Maybe two meetings tops, and the amount of time really just depends on how many proposals we receive. I think last time we received 4 or 5 proposals, if I remember correctly. And so it's a 30-page document, and it's a matter of going through that. So I spend at least 2 hours, and that's just me. I have to. I think some people maybe spend a lot less than me, but I spend about 2 hours per each proposal making sure that I'm going through and catching everything.
For the record, I like to volunteer.
Okay.
Any other questions from the commission, from the public?
Okay, our action is to recommend advertise for the RFQ. So I would entertain a motion for such.
I motion to recommend that we move this on to City Council to send out this RFQ.
I don't think this goes to City Council, does it? This is just to go out for RFQ.
This is not going to City Council.
Oh, this isn't. Yeah. Oh, then I recommend that we approve this and send it out.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Not. Roll call, please. Christine.
Commissioner Sonio?
Approved.
Commissioner Force?
Approved.
Commissioner Johnson?
Approved.
Commissioner Purvis? Commissioner Shoemaker?
Approve.
Commissioner White?
Approve.
Chairperson McGregor?
Aye.
Okay, we're down to administrative reports. Airport rates and fee schedule for 2018-19. Popular topic.
Yeah, it's always a popular topic. This is, again, just an update. Let the commission know exactly where we are in the process, and it's a short update. The Bureau of Labor Statistics actually published their February data, and so we have that data in. And it was 3.6% was from February 2017 to February 2018. So this is the information that we're going to move forward presenting the tenants and the associations around the airport with. And when we start building our comparison charts, that we will be using the 3.6% increase as a data point. What I will say is we were going to come to the commission next month, and we're going to provide alternatives to the commission based off of different data values. And I think 3.6% would be the highest data value. I think we'd like to provide some other data values that might be a little bit less than that and let the commission consider that. So at May, we will present the full report at the Salinas Owners and Pilots Association meeting. And during the month of May, we'll also go ahead and mail out those rate alternatives to the tenant base. And I think something that me and my staff might do a little different is actually encourage the tenants to come to these meetings. They seem to be the most popular meetings. And I think it's more transparent if we're actively saying, you know, if the commission wants to hear from you guys. I think I've talked to a couple of you commissioners, and I believe, without speaking on behalf of the commission, that you would like to see the tenants come here, especially for something of this nature when we're adjusting the rates and fees. And me personally, I'd like to hear from them. So, and the ultimate goal is to have this in front of City Council in June so the rates can be effective in July. Any questions on that?
Have you heard anything?
No, at the April meeting, I presented the data to SOPA, but I had just gotten the data the day of, and so I hadn't even had the opportunity to really sit there and analyze what the data meant. But I presented it to SOPA, and it's a rate increase, so that is what that is. It's never anything positive, but I mean, I think it's expected that they know each year we're coming to them to present them the rate increase, but nonetheless, it's not roses when you present this information. So.
Any questions? Commissioner Johnson?
Wasn't last year where you were kind of trying to catch up from previous years, and you did a little bit higher of a percent, and then you were talking about catching up again in 2018, I believe. And are we not going to do that? Is it going to be the 3.6%, which was the index?
My recommendation this year is we don't go any higher than 3.6%. That's
what?
My recommendation, if it was today, would be not to go any higher than 3.6%. And the only reason I'm saying this is when at the last commission meeting, when I presented the data sets for the previous months before this, it was at 3.0 and 2.9%. And then we have a spike in the CPI over 1 month. And I don't know if that's because we've chosen February, and February
is right after Christmas time, and typically the economy does pretty good around Christmas time. I've been trying to track that from year to year to see if we see those spikes in February, and if February is the higher spike. But what I can say is when I presented the data set to you last month, my estimate that it was going to be somewhere around 3%. And then when it was published, it was 3.6%. So I think this is a higher data set that we've had through the rest of the year. So my recommendation would be 3.6 would be the highest that we go.
Any other questions? Questions from the public? Comment? Not. We'll move on to the next item, the Bill Potts painting lease amendment.
This will be something that will be reoccurring for the next few months. Bill Potts paint. Let me see if I have a picture in one of these other slides. I don't know if this will do it justice. But Bill Potts paint is in the orange area over here on the east side of the airport. I don't think the laser works on this, or maybe it does. Oh, it does work. Bill Potts paint is located here, and then for you guys that are over here that can see it, this is Bill Potts paint. So this is in reference. There's nothing built around this site. It's nothing but unimproved land. They entered into a lease with the city of Salinas back in the 1960s, and they had essentially a 50-year deal, and they've done, or 40-year deal, and they've done some amendments to increase their lease out. Well, they finally, this is one of the first leases here on the airport that is actually coming to an end. He has expressed interest in extending the terms of his lease with the city of Salinas. But you have to understand, in the leases, we have reversionary clauses built into the leases. And so at the end of the lease, when all your options have expired, the city has rights to the improvements on those land. The leases are structured so as during the initial term and options of the leases that we're charging ground rent only, nothing for the improvements. So nothing for the structure. And that makes sense because you have private investors such as Potts Paints that come onto the airport and invest in the facility, and they need to recoup their investment and amortize their loan. And so we offer them a lower rate, which is ground rate. And so for the last 50 years, they've paid for ground rate. And so with their lease expiring, we have the option to take back the facility and do improvements to it. And then we own the facility, and so we can charge a ground rate for the pavement and the dirt that someone would like to lease, and then a facility rate, which is typically more than a ground rate. Or there's other options where, depending on the circumstances, and it's really from each circumstance is different, because you have to analyze what the asset is and what the proposal is. And currently right now, The asset, the facility, is in disrepair, and that's primarily because the leaseholder hasn't done any improvements to the facility almost since day one, it looks like. And they've come to us and proposed that they'd like to do investments in the facility and have a lease with the city of Salinas just for a ground rate, and they maintain ownership for the building. And so the way that we, the city, look at this is, okay, well, if we were to take back the facility, what is it that we could charge for the facility based off of a ground rate and a facility rate? And then we compare that to if we were to continue leasing out the facility, what is it that we could theoretically get for just a ground rate? And then we compare that to some other variables. Charlie Potts, or Potts Paint, has expressed that they would like to invest a significant amount of money back into the facility and recoup the, or bring the facility up to standard. So it's a significant investment, upwards over $100,000 that would have to be invested in the facility just to bring it up to standard. The doors have to be rebuilt, the asphalt has to be repaved, the roof has to be re-roofed. Everything has to be done to this facility. And so We are currently negotiating and reviewing a proposal whereby he has to provide certain deliverables to us so that way we can fully analyze it. We're drafting a draft lease with a city attorney right now that would stipulate, based off the amount of investment, is how much term we'd be willing to offer him. And the maximum term right out of the gate is 10 years. So if he's interested in leasing the facility, we're only interested in doing 10 years of leasing. And I'd like to explain that partly. When we're looking at the airport, oh no, I pushed the wrong button. Oh, there we go. When we're looking at the airport and we're looking at the future needs of the airport, currently, and we've discussed this with the commission, we're currently in exclusive negotiating agreements to develop the core area out front. And the city is also analyzing a potential commercial hangar development over here on the south side. The next logical space for us to move development to is over here on the east side. And so we don't want to be in a position where we lock ourselves into a long-term lease in the event we need to go back and redevelop this entire area. It might not make sense for us to enter in a 40-year agreement and be stuck with the development out here if it doesn't flow with the overall development that's being planned. And so we can engage in 10 years. I think 10 years is adequate. By the time we get to the point where we finish all of these developments and start really considering the east side development, 10 years would be fine, and probably even entering into another 10-year agreement after that would probably be fine too, just looking at the current market and conditions right now. So 10 years is all that we'd be willing to lock in. So the proposal that will eventually come to the commission is locked into a 10-year, and we're requiring a certain amount of investment in the facility to bring it up to standards with adjustments and rates to account for. When the last time we just finished an appraisal in 2015, we did an appraisal of this facility, and the appraiser came back with 20 cents a square foot. We just completed an appraisal on the facility about a week ago, and they've since then, the appraisal is somewhere around 24 cents a square foot. And so the land value is slowly escalating. So we also don't want to lock ourselves into something so long as that the rates and fees become out of alignment what the market would bear for an aeronautical development. So this is kind of just a very high level overview that we're going to be coming to the commission here with a potential lease for POTS paint with a lease that is fully expired, all the options terms. And we're going to be analyzing whether it's best to take back the facility as the city of Salinas and own it outright, or if we lease it back to him for a short-term lease of 10 years with significant investment. Questions?
I have a couple of questions. Number one, hasn't there been or isn't there problems with his water supply and or wastewater, sewage and whatnot over there? Has that been resolved, or where is that these days?
So that, to date, has not been resolved. So he used to have a water supply to his facility, and that came off the golf course. And the golf course did some improvements, and I believe that they started pumping fertilizers through their water system, and so they were required to cut him off. And that happened, I'm not sure, was that during your tenure, Earl? Mark Batista. So we're talking 2001 to 2005 timeframe is when that happened. And he's always had the option to install a water line. One of the requirements of what's been being negotiated in his lease is that he will bring water to the property. That is one of the requirements.
Okay, he does have sewage there.
So he's connected to
it. He has a septic tank.
Yeah, it's all on septic tank. Mm-hmm. Even with, what's he do with the chemicals from the painting and whatnot? Does he carry those off separately? How does that?
I believe it's mixed. There's some stuff. Well, I know everything's carried off site. He can't dispose it into a septic tank, nor can he just push it out off onto for the stormwater to carry it off.
But how he collects it, everything's done within the hangar, and I believe he has the ability to clean it off and haul it off.
Okay.
How he manages it.
That's a question. Is Commissioner Forrest?
First of all, it sounds like his track record is not very, very good. 50 years and no improvements at all?
There's been some. There just hasn't been any in the last 15 to 20 years. So, and I couldn't speak to what those were that happened prior to 15 years. So it looks like it was, and I don't mean to be negative. It just looks like the place was built 50 years ago and then nothing was done with it.
If he was to walk and we brought, you know, that back to the city, what would it cost the city to improve that land to be leased out again?
My estimate is somewhere in very rough dollars, at least $100,000 of investment for us to do.
So he is offering to do another lease for 10 years to bring it up to standards at $100,000.
Minimum of $100,000 is what it would be. Yeah.
Are you going to have, you know, in the lease, I mean, you know, to protect the city, you know, that he does improve the, you know, have these improvements?
Yes. So under the term sections in the lease, it'll be structured out that so much investment has to occur within the first several years of the lease. Otherwise, the additional time is negated. And so if he comes in and invests $50,000 the first year and doesn't meet the additional $50,000 as a minimum, the lease can be written in such a manner that would negate so many years off of the 10 years. So it ties your hands to investment.
Understand, if the city allows the lease, how long is he going to have to do the improvements of the $100,000? Is he going to get 5 years to take care of those issues?
Through most of our conversations, most of the investment would have to happen within the first 2 years, 24 months. And the only circumstances that would push it out beyond that would be if there was something in permitting that hung up the process. So,
and if he didn't do any of those improvements within the first 2 years, we're going to have some way of, you know, making the lease void.
Yes. In the term section, and it'll be written throughout there. So right now, currently, the city attorney is reviewing the proposed terms and structuring that language into the agreement.
And one last thing, I think if he were to do something like that, that there should be some penalties in that lease that if he doesn't follow through, that there should be some penalties on top of.
I'm interested if any one of the commissioners would like to sit and talk about this, and if you have any recommendations, more than willing to hear anything else about something like that. So,
Commissioner Soniel.
Yeah, there's a couple things. First of all, what Mr. Potts will do with $100,000, the city of Salinas wouldn't be able to touch for $200,000 or $300,000 by the time you throw in prevailing wage and sort of other craziness. But this, more importantly, the city of Salinas and the county of Monterey are notorious for driving away business. We have a viable tenant here. Mm-hmm. I think we should work very, very much with him to keep him here. Okay? Mm-hmm. Prioritize a laundry list of improvements that need to be done. Mm-hmm. You know, safety issues would be at the top of the list. Give him the timeline to be done and let him do it. I'd also like to see the building department work with him in getting these things done as opposed to throwing the book at him and for a lot of unnecessary upgrades.
I agree. The fact that we have the opportunity to take back the facility and we're engaging the idea of maintaining him as a tenant in that facility is, I understand that he's an existing tenant.
I don't think we should take back. I think we should work with him, keeping him as a tenant.
And so the last thing that I'm moving forward in good faith, and we're working on developing lease and met all the timelines that we've with me working with Charlie Potts on this. The last thing, and I've talked about this with some commissioners, is you have to understand that we have several accounts with this tenant, and two of the accounts are delinquent. We just got this account up and current this year. And so one of the conditions of me moving forward with this endeavor, with us leasing the facility out, was that he would become current by, I'm trying to remember the date, Chris.
He rents other property on the airport?
It was April 1st.
April 1st. And so we're in April and his account still is not current. And so me moving forward, I will write the report when we move forward, and if he's not current by the report, I will go ahead and put this in front of the commission and let the commission decide if you'd like to provide a recommendation, but I will not provide a recommendation from the city standpoint that we move forward with a tenant that is delinquent in rents. So
what is he delinquent on? What other properties?
So he had three accounts. He had this leasehold that we're talking about. We have a Charlie row hanger and then the H row hanger.
But I don't think we should be mixing apples and oranges here. If he's delinquent on those two hangers, boot him out and work with him on this. I mean, late rent, I mean, that's 30-day eviction notice right there.
Oh, yeah.
So we can exercise that.
We work with tenants. We're patient with tenants. And so we try to work with them and maintain them. But I'm just letting you know, we just finally came current with this tenant 2 months ago, I think. 3 months ago?
On this property, yeah. On the painting property.
Mm-hmm.
But not with the hangers, correct?
Not with the hangers.
Yeah.
Well, it's two separate issues, though. Or three separate issues, actually.
Commissioner Shoemaker?
Because the city has a reversionary policy, which means that the owner builds a building and then has to give it up and can't sell it like a developer would, it's not surprising that you would find an owner sometimes using up a building before they have to walk away from it. So I'm not surprised by that condition. Mm-hmm. The other conditions, how good a tenant is he? Is he an actual tenant? Are the conditions we want to look at? Mm-hmm. So, not really surprised by the whole situation.
Yeah. You answered one of my questions. The other one was, when does his lease actually expire?
In August.
August.
Okay, so we got some time.
Any other questions from the comments from the commission?
I just have a commission comment, another comment. On one side, he proposes $100,000. On the other side, the city says, okay, we're going to pull the lease. Now, here's another $100,000 is going to have to be to improve the property. So either way, there's $100,000 coming from somebody.
Well, there is a third option. The third option is we ask him to remove the facility and turn the facility back to as it was before. Before they started leasing it, so there is a third option, and just keep in mind the minimum investment to do the work that needs to be done is $100,000, and we're just talking the basic stuff such as replacing the doors that are off tracks that don't slide anymore, and replacing skylights and doing asphalt work, and the $100,000 is just the minimum. Based off of an estimate, going around and picking the most serious items. So I anticipate the investment will be much more than that. So,
okay. Any other questions, comments from the commission, from the public? Okay. There's no action required on this, so we can go on to announcements. Anybody have any announcements? Are there any comments from the public? Ms. Atkinson.
I just wanted to comment about the airport business that was robbed this past week. And I know the airport business that was robbed this past week, and I know the people were caught. In conversations that I've had with the police department in the past, they were unaware that it's a federal offense to enter the airport or steal from the airport. So I'm wondering if additional charges will be filed against the three parties that were arrested for trespassing on the airport, accessing the fence. I know that you don't have anything to do with that, but I'm just wondering if that could be put out there.
Yeah. We actually just found out about that today.
Oh.
Yeah, no one had come to us and told us that that they'd
been broken
into. I actually
read it in the newspaper.
Who was
you
robbed?
Read it in the newspaper?
Yeah.
Oh,
who was robbed?
SeaTac.
SeaTac was... Were they robbed or were they not robbed? Or
They were robbed. The owner of SeaTac has been hit several times, and there was an attempt late last year, and they actually cut the fence line at our property and went around the back and cut their fence line. So they put in a security system, and it went off, and the owner was actually monitoring the people on the monitors. The police were en route to pick them up. They caught them with $24,000 worth of equipment that luckily was recovered.
Wow.
And the three men were arrested.
SeaTac.
It's the former Gomes building. But,
did the Gomes have problems when they were there?
No. I think one of the issues is the type of equipment that SeaTac deals with is construction equipment. It's easy to take. It's easy to pawn. But I think that in prosecuting these people, it needs to be brought to their attention that it's a federal offense to cut an airport fence and trespass on an airport, and just asking that maybe that gets tacked on.
You'd have to call the county prosecutor or the office, yeah.
Can I?
I'll bring that up to the city attorney and see if he can work with them. So.
Could I say something? Can I say something?
Commissioner Johnson?
Just for clarification, when you're robbed, it means that somebody comes in and physically puts fear into you to take your belongings.
So it was a burglary and not
a robbery? So it's a burglary when they come in the middle of the when there's nobody else there. The two offenses are, you know, clearly different in prosecuting, but it's interesting about the federal part.
Okay, any other comments, public? Future agenda items? Seeing none, next meeting date is Thursday, May 24th. And with that, the meeting is adjourned.